I'll just continue. Yes. So I was saying, all people are coming. Okay, let me just wait for a few minutes. So far, whatever I've said, is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Básicamente, este grupo de las rosas fue un grupo medio entre comunismo y capitalismo.
Se puede decir que eran ni me, no medio, eran es socialismo. Eran grupos
Socialismo.
líderes que sí que apoyaban socialismo, pero manteniendo la fábrica democrática de su país.
Como India, de Jawaharlal Nehru.
Sí, exactamente.
Vale.
Sí. ¿Vale? Pero claro, era más complicado para ellos porque tuvieron que resistir a la influencia de América Latina, ¿no?
Vale.
Que era que Jawaharlal Nehru no tenía ese reto, podemos decir, porque todavía el mundo era en dos bloques y era mejor no participar en all in line movement. So, you know,
Sí.
that standoff, saying that we will be a socialist democratic country. It was very different. The context is very different. That's why we can't compare the two. So this is a very unique to Latin America 2000s phenomena. No se puede comparar con otros países y otras situaciones, ¿vale?
Vale.
Entonces, todo esto hay que recordar que eran líderes que eran izquierdistas, ¿no? Pero mantenían la democracia en su país, intentaban mantener su democracia. Y con estos, una de las características más importantes de ese movimiento era confrontación o el enfrentamiento con Estados Unidos. Okay, that is
Vale,
like
señora.
what defines this movement. It was more than what they did at their own level of economics, right, within the country. Of course, there were nationalizations. These are leftist measures, leftist measures. But one of the main features is being against US and collaboration between each other. Right? Entonces, por eso decir, como marea, ¿no? Como una tide, como algo que poco a poco difundió por todas partes de América Latina y ellos, los líderes que uno por uno tomaron el poder, asumieron el poder en sus países, también empezaron a colaborar con el uno con otro. Okay, that is what makes this a very distinct feature, a very distinct thing. So the existence of left-wing party in a democracy is not something very surprising. For example, Spain has, ¿no? Spain tiene el partido PSOE, ¿no? Que es socialista, que dice que es
Sí.
socialista. ¿Vale? Entonces, por todas partes en Europa existe democracias donde hay tantos países, perdón, pa partidos políticos derechistas como izquierdistas, ¿no? Who are socialists, who call themselves socialists. So that's not a very unique phenomenon. What is unique to Pink Tide in Latin America es un rechazo del imperialismo, del dominio de estadounidense. ¿Ok? de cooperación regional, ¿vale? De un intento de cooperar regionalmente. Incluso, por ejemplo, Hugo Chávez, con la ayuda de Hugo Chávez, otros líderes, establecen un banco, el Banco del Sur. Okay, so the what I was telling you, that Washington Consensus, one of the main ways of that control in the internal matters of countries have been through these economic package, which is given by the World Bank and the IMF, no, Monetary Fund. So that's why the Latin American leaders felt that if we are not going to work according to US, according to US's favored policies, then they are not going to support us. But in order to survive, again, like trade makes everything go around, right? And without the support of financial aid and with going against US has been very difficult for Latin American governments, no? So whoever has tried to go against Latin America has failed. Whoever in Latin America has tried to go against US generally have failed in the past. That's the examples that we have. So that's why these leaders created El Banco del Sur, no, y otros tratados y otras maneras de hacer cooperación, porque tenía esa filosofía común que necesitan ser independientes, ¿no? Y frenar a la influencia de estadounidense. It is one of the criticism. Now let's see. You guys, is this on slideshow mode? Once again. So one of the, for example, there's a lot of criticism. Okay, so look at this. This is written by Alvaro Vargas Llosa. Okay, he's the son of Mario Vargas Llosa, who is a Nobel laureate winner, writer of Latin America, right? So here he's calling them an idiot. All right, the return of the idiot. When what we are referring to as the return of populismo, aquí se lo considera como un idiota. ¿Por qué? Mira, por eso hay esa imagen, ¿no? Toda esa gente. Hay una relación entre los populistas de los años 30 e incluso los dictadores anteriores con esas personas nuevas. La crítica aquí es que no funciona, no es beneficiosa tener esa relación de enemigos con Estados Unidos, ¿ok? So una parte muy grande de América Latina cree que Estados Unidos, que los latinoamericanos necesitan el apoyo de Estados Unidos. Les gustaría ser amigos con los Estados Unidos, ¿ok? So a part of, so someone who has written this article, he believes that what the populist does is that it misuses the popular sentiment of people against US, right? They misuse that, right? So they remain in power, they become popular by constantly criticizing and showing that, oh, we are not letting US do anything, we are going against the US, so whatever problems we are facing, again, blaming it on the US, no? This can be considered, it can be, some people have blamed Hugo Chavez of doing this in an exaggerated way, right? And at the expense of his country, right? Because those are the people who would say that that this doesn't make sense, okay? It's idiotic to be to all the time be like es los Estados Unidos es un diablo, yes, whatever, you know, and we are against them. So that is not helpful. It would be more helpful, more beneficial for the economy to collaborate with United States, right? But of course, the moment there is, it's also true that the moment they, one would want to collaborate with the United States, they have always imposed their own ways of doing things, and it doesn't go with the philosophy of these leaders at all, right? So because they want to, they do not want the kind of liberalization that US thinks is basic, right? US thinks that is the basic thing to do, to have that kind of liberalization, right? So going back to this is one of the key characteristics, okay, being against US, all right, and being criticizing imperialism, criticizing the dominance of US and Europeans on Latin America from the time of the independence, right? So, estos líderes intentan relacionar con las clases bajas, la gente indígena, los trabajadores de sus países para mantener en el poder y para venir a los asientos de poder, ¿no? Bueno, y tenemos Hugo Chávez era como la figura más importante de esa tendencia. Tenemos también Evo Morales, ¿ok? Evo Morales era el presidente desde 2006 hasta 2019. Y ahora, ¿qué dice Evo Morales? Por ejemplo, a la hora de la coca, ¿no? Coca. Es una... Él dijo, coca sí, cocaína no, ¿no? Entonces, ¿qué significa? Que quiere decir que la cosecha, ¿no? Cosechar la coca, you know, producing, agriculturally producing coca leaves is something that their population have always done. So, US, of course, wanted, because US, when they wanted to control drug trafficking and control the use of drug in their country, they asked Bolivia, they asked, this has been going on for before Evo Morales came to power also. This used to happen that US army would actually come down to Bolivia and clear the coca fields. They will capture or torture or simply beat up the people who are involved, right? So in a way, what was the situation under the US influence in Bolivia was that coca should not be produced in Bolivia. Why? Because in US there's a drug problem. There's a problem of cocaine, okay, in US. So Evo Morales points out that US should solve the drug problem on its own, but not by asking Bolivia not to produce coca, because coca is not just cocaine, it's not the same thing. Okay, so coca can be produced and it has been part of their culture, their other things are done with coca. It's not like, that's why I've given this photo, like they you can make tea with coca, you can make medicines with coca. So coca is not necessarily the same as cocaine. So we will not stop, I will not ask my farmers, what will my farmers do if they don't produce coca, you know? So I will share a clip with you, which is about how Colombia is this other country which has always functioned it's very cooperative. Colombia is not part of this pink tide thing, right? Colombia has never had, since the 1990s, Colombia has constantly worked in favor of US. So in Colombia, that still goes on, okay? The coming down, and there's this very beautiful short video which shows that what are the problems, you know, what will a farmer in rural Colombia do if he doesn't have if he doesn't do this, right? So even if it's banned, people will still do it because that's the only way for them to survive, right? So they do it, but then they are, often someone comes down and burns everything, right? So they suffer a lot. So Evo Morales, one of the things, this is an example. Why am I saying this? But this is an example of standing up, you know, saying that we won't, just because US is asking me to ban coca production, I will not ban coca production. I am not producing drugs. I'm producing a crop. And that crop is getting converted into drugs by somebody else. That's not my problem. Okay? So, of course, you know, these are like, we can say that it's wrong or whatever, but these are one of the first incidents or examples of standing against US, doing something that goes against what the US is asking them to do. And that is new for like Latin marijuana. America.
Just like marijuana in Mexico.
Yeah. So in Mexico, marijuana must be banned. It must be, you can't, you know, produce marijuana, right? In Mexico, as far as I know. Because this is only Evo Morales have done this with coca leaves. Otherwise, producing these things which are used for intoxication and all, are mostly banned everywhere. Most governments ban the production, right? But Evo Morales has done this unique thing by saying that, no, I would not. It is the only way my people survive, right? So that's the thing, right? These are examples of saying that, no, esto, esa la cuestión de identidad, because as you can see, Evo Morales is the first indigenous leader of Latin America to say that this is part of our identity, of our culture. You wouldn't even understand that. So, you know, we can't give up on something which was part of our identity, our culture for generations. And that is true. Of course, it's true, right? So, estas cosas, ¿vale? Estas son las cosas que diferencian a estos líderes de todos los líderes que hemos visto antes, ¿vale? En América Latina. Okay? But if you see both of them, their terms from 98 to 2013, from 2006 to 2019, these are very long terms, right? So one of the things that they are accused of is that once they came to power, they didn't let anyone else come to power. They had elections, they got re-elected. People say that, for example, in case of Bolivia, Evo Morales tried to change the laws so that he can come to power again, but he was not allowed. So there was recently a lot of turmoil in Bolivia over this. Okay, so he has just recently stepped down, and he has been accused of corruption and things like that. So he is right now he's like a political prisoner sort of a thing. He's not very free right now. Okay. So Hugo Chavez died. So with these changes, of course, the movement has suffered and it's not so strong anymore. And there is a return of right-wing governments, conservative governments in Latin America. Okay. The other names, you guys might have heard of these people. I don't know. It might not have also. You guys were in school when we were in college and all. They were quite popular. Like Lula da Silva was very popular in India. You know, bahut uski charcha hoti thi India mein. Because why? Because Chile, Brazil, as you know that there are these G5 countries, no? Brazil is one of them.
Yes, ma'am.
Right?
Yes, ma'am. BRICS.
So, yeah. So, BRICS. So that status, you know, taking Brazil to that level happened under Lula da Silva, okay? And Lula da Silva was a very popular leader because he was from the Workers' Party, so he was again socialist in that sense, and he did a lot of work for the workers, right? For the common people of its country. of his country. He is also, Lula da Silva was also the person who introduced, again, see, regional cooperation is one of the features. So Lula da Silva said that Brazil is the only non-Spanish speaking country. All our neighbors speak Spanish. So we must study Spanish. So he made studying Spanish compulsory in school in Brazil. Okay, so that was an example of being of encouraging regional cooperation. Okay, so Brazil and Chile I've put here because these are countries which do very well in Latin America. Okay, Venezuela doesn't in today's point. So it's very easy to sort of say ki ye movement was not very successful, because if you look at Venezuela's condition today, it is in a very big crisis. So those who want to dismiss this movement or this kind of politics can easily tell you that Venezuela did not gain anything because of Hugo Chavez. But if somebody wants to defend Hugo Chavez, they would say that, well, because he died after that, the problem started emerging because of the political lack of political consensus after his death, right? And because of the bad leaderships after his death and everything. But it's not directly result of his policies. Okay. But these two examples are examples of people under whom their country really progressed a lot. Okay. And Chile is one of the most successful economies. Brazil is also a successful economy of Latin America, but Chile is also considered to be a very successful economy. Okay. All right, these are their terms, and then we have these other examples of smaller countries. They have not done extraordinarily well also, but they have introduced some measures which can be said that have done well for the people, but they are mixed. Okay, they are not the most extraordinarily successful leaders. But there are many others, okay? So this happens all over Latin America. I just want you guys to remember these few names. In case of Daniel Ortega, I said that he was part of the movement against Somoza dynasty, right? And then so much has happened and he is still the president of Nicaragua, right? So he was part of the Movimiento Que Hemos Visto, ASALN, you know, that movement. Sí. And he is the current president of Nicaragua, right? Then we have Nicanor Duarte, who was president from 2003 to 2008. Rafael Correa in Ecuador, okay? The most common feature in all of them is that they openly supported Hugo Chavez, okay? So they would have summits, they would have meetings, there would be photographs. So this whole solidarity amongst Latin American country under the leadership of Hugo Chavez was something new that happened because as part of the pink tide. Okay. All right. But yes, there is a very strong criticism. I will share this article with you guys to know what are the different points. But the main point, by the way, Hugo Chavez is, of course, a very big supporter of Fidel Castro. So whenever these people met and they had agreements, Fidel Castro was part of that group of Latin American leaders who are supporting each other, right? Who are telling the world that they are together, right? So he was part of, Fidel Castro was also part of that, right? So la crítica es que el populismo es peligroso para la democracia. ¿Vale? Por ejemplo, lo que vemos en Venezuela, porque todas las medidas, todo dependía a una figura, ¿no? A Chávez. Como Chávez es el centro de todo el sistema venezolano. Y cuando murió por algo natural, de repente era ese vacío que se creaba por su muerte, nadie ha podido rellenar a ese vacío. So nobody has been able to fill this gap that has got created because of his death. And since then, Venezuela has been facing problems after problems because it is just it depended too much on Chavez, right? Which is not the ideal situation. No democracy should depend so much on one person. It should be the institutions that function well, right? So policies and economic policies and everything should be directed to such a situation that the whole structure works. The structure doesn't depend on one leader, right? Because democracies are not supposed to be one leader oriented things, right? It's not a business ki business ka CEO hai wo manage kar raha hai sahi se, aur wo CEO agar nahi raha, wo CEO mar gaya ya kuch ho gaya, to business crash kar jati hai na. Aisa hota hai business mein, but governments and countries and states shouldn't function like that. This is one of the main criticism of this trend of populism, right? That it was all depended on one figure. Jaise abhi hum Bolivia ko abhi hum dekhenge. 2019 tak Bolivia was in very good economic shape as well. But now we will see, now that he has been removed, whether the country survives or we have a situation like Venezuela. All right? So, okay. But even the fact that he has been removed, that's a little problematic, the way he has been removed. But also it was problematic that he was not being removed. So it shouldn't be ki ek jaise US ka jo system hai, you know, no matter what, no matter how great a president one becomes, 8 years, right? 2 terms, not more than 2 terms, no matter what you do in your terms. So that is their way of safeguarding their democracy. So wo kharab se kharab insaan ko bhi agar log vote dene ko taiyar hai, still wo do hi baar aa sakte. Jaise Trump abhi dusri baar aayega ki nahi, people are thinking about that. But agar Trump aa bhi gaya to bhi wo uska last term hoga, that we know ki uske baad nahi hoga, right? So this will end. So that is how democracies should ideally be. There should be a limit to how many times a person can come to power and stay in power, how long in continuation they can stay in power. Okay. Now, what is happening now in Latin America is that there is a return to right-wing parties in some countries. Okay. It has not yet become a complete regional phenomena. It has not happened everywhere, as you just saw. Daniel Ortega is still in power. There are leaders who are still in power, but this one as well. No. Okay. But with Macri, Bolsonaro, and Piñera. Bolsonaro is Brazil, Piñera Chile, and Macri is Argentina. Okay, so again, the countries which had the worst dictatorships, the bureaucratic authoritarian dictatorships, they are again back to having nearly extremely right-wing governments. Okay, Bolsonaro ko to fascist bola jata hai. Bolsonaro has said things like he doesn't care if the Amazon burns down. He did not take any measures for COVID-19. So Brazil right now is under his leadership in COVID-19, Brazil is in very deep trouble. So these are right-wing governments that have started taking over. This is a very recent phenomenon. 2017, 18, 19, this is how it is happening, okay, one by one. So basically what I want you guys to conclude, you know, this whole thing is that if you go back to this, of course, we have seen that there's a tendency, you know, it is also called the political pendulum, okay? Like a pendulum goes on two sides, right? So we can say that Latin America sort of has that kind of an experience. Wo ek bar left wing, ek bar right wing, ek bar left wing, ek bar right wing, hota rehta hai wahan par. Okay? And we can also say that is one, a reflection of the divisions in the country that still exist. Kyunki koi bhi ek political party is not able to propose, you know, reforms or things that is acceptable to the entire population. Okay, so when the population is divided into these classes who have very different understanding of what is good for them and what they want, right? So the business class, the landowning class, they would always want more benefits for them, for the market, less taxations, right? Free market, less intervention by the government, so that they can make more and more profit. And of course, the other side, which is the people who are workers, they would always want the government to be more protective, the government to provide a lot of things for free, basic things like health, education, living space, you know, unemployment benefits. So obviously, because of these differences, now when they have elections, this will go on happening, right? The different sides, left wing will come to power, right wing will come to power, and you know it will keep on happening. It's a very natural thing. It is a good thing that the pink tide took place, because it was for the world a renewal of the faith in socialism. Okay, so the disintegration of Soviet Union and the fall of the Berlin Wall, all those things, it seemed, the world seemed to think that US has won, capitalism has won this game and socialism has lost this game. Okay, but pink tide is like a resurgence of socialism, and it is still surviving in many places in Latin America. It is very difficult for socialism to survive, because it is true that every country at the end of the world needs, at the end of the day, needs more and more economic growth, and economic growth is how they will be able to survive. If they want to do anything good for society, for the majority of the people, everything comes from a good economy, a good economic system, right? So, but capitalism is not the only way for that economic system to survive. This is an idea that is alive in Latin America, and that is also alive in other parts of the world. It's very alive in US, in Europe. It is there in US as well. In fact, in US, there's a rethinking of how this function, and that's why you have a candidate like Bernie Sanders in the next, who is campaigning for the next election. So there is a talk in US to think of some of these ideas which are socialist in nature, and in Europe there's a very strong Green Party movement. Okay, they are people who say that capitalism is problematic because it is not sustainable, it is against the environment. So it's not so much about socialism, but because Europe already has the basic estado de bienestar, they already have that, so they already agree with that part of the idea that the state must provide basic things like education and health. But also, they are capitalist, of course, you know, all these countries, Germany and all, but they are also very pro-environment, right? So that's a new phenomena of politics, which is the green politics, right? Green parties, which is strong in Europe, but we can hope that over time it will, you know, go, it will come in different parts of the world. Okay. So that's it from my side. That's the end of our syllabus. Okay. Everything I have talked about, and this last, I've shared it in the classroom. So you have these links. You have to watch this documentary, War on Democracy, by John Pilger. It's part of our syllabus. It is very important to watch this documentary to understand Chavez and Morales a little bit better, and also understand US intervention, even with Chavez and Morales. So even as recent as 2000s, tak bhi US intervention chalta aa raha hai. Okay? So US intervention kahin nahi gaya hai. Nothing has changed in that regard. right? And this fight against, you know, this desire in Latin Americans to create something, to have their own independent, prosperous nations without facing U.S. intervention, this is also alive. And there's the struggle is going on in Latin America. Okay, this is the takeaway I want you to remember from after studying the entire history of Latin America. I want you guys to remember that there are no final answers yet about any of the things that surrounds us. All right. So whether capitalism is a good thing or bad thing, whether socialism is a good thing or a bad thing, whether state should provide basic facilities, whether state should not intervene in the market or should it intervene in the market, is neoliberalism a good thing, is globalization a good thing, you know, and how much should environment be kept in mind whenever we are talking about the market and the economy and all that. These are all questions that across the world are being discussed and debated. And our job is to learn to participate in that debate and not have our own fixed opinions about things. Okay? So, if you want, I can restart another meeting if you have any questions. I do have 1 minute left for in this meeting. So just let me know if there's anything you guys want to know more or discuss more, then I'll start another meeting. Otherwise, my lecture is over. Should I start another call after this call ends?
If you have a question, then we ask by a WhatsApp message.
Okay. All right. Okay. That's okay. And for the next week, whatever I have told you that we are going to do. Okay. For the next week.
Okay, ma'am.
That plan is on. All right.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. We need some time to watch this movie.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Adios.